trustworthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened worship as Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 108. Nibbana, Paranang Sukkang. Nibbana is the highest bliss, as the Buddha said. Thank you for your advantageous attention. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 108, on an important subject, the final goal, Nibbana, which is the highest happiness, Nibbana, Paranang Sukkang, as the Buddha explained it. There is three questions in total, but first, the normal intro. Namo tasso bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. It's a very nice morning here in Denmark, a little bit chilly, September 2018, under a huge tree, fitting for the subject of Nibbana. Question 333, what is the difference between Nibbana, Nirvana? Nibbana is a Pali word, Nirvana is a Sanskrit pronunciation, and being enlightened. And being enlightened is the state of attaining awakening, Bodhi. And the state one experiences there, and there's actually two of them, so there's two Nibbanas, two Nirvanas, two state dimensions of Nirvana, is the experience of this worthy one, this Arahant. Before we venture into this, I'd like to say that Nibbana is, strictly speaking, inexpressible. Because it is not only unimaginable, one cannot imagine it, because one has never tried it before. If you imagine something, then you imagine remote memories that are partially subconscious and incomplete. Then you say, ah, this is a free fantasy. No, it's conditioned events. But since there is nothing in the database, we have never tried Nibbana before, then we cannot imagine it. We cannot drag any traces out of our subconscious mind that has experienced all these prior lives, about anything about how Nibbana is. This is the first issue. It is unimaginable. Then also it is inexpressible, ineffable, as it's said with another word. Why so? Because language is developed to express things here in samsara, forms, colors, emotions, thoughts, ideas, and so on. But this is all included in samsara. It's included in space-time. It is thereby characterized by the three universal characteristics of anicca, dukkha, and anatta. And this is Nibbana, not. It's not anicca. Nibbana is timeless, akaliko, and also not a point in space. And this means there's no language that has been developed to express it, and therefore it cannot be expressed. But we will try anyway, and I will try to keep as close as to what the Buddha said about it, because he had direct experience of it. And then we can see whether we can get a gist of it. However, one should be careful about getting this gist, because one usually tries to intellectualize your way to Nibbana with analytical thinking, for example. And this is not possible, because it is, even in principle, unimaginable and unexpressible. But something can be said about it anyway, that can, without misleading, lead the way along and across to it. So first of all, this about this, the two dimensions of Nibbana. There's this Nibbana in this very life, this we call Nibbana sa upadisesa. It is the state of Nibbana with some old accumulations of clinging left, or resulting becoming caused by clinging in the past. This is a arahat that here in this life, before he dies, still having some traces, some accumulations of old clinging. He stopped clinging at the moment of enlightenment, but then further upstream there has been some clinging, and the results of that, the karmic results of that clinging, still is lingering on. And then there's Nibbana with no substrates of being left, Nibbana anupadisesa. And this is what the arahant goes into or experiences or transcends when dying. The Blessed Buddha, he said it thus about these two aspects of Nibbana, one can also say. Because there are these two Nibbana elements, Nibbana dattus. What are the two? The Nibbana element with residue left, and the Nibbana element without any traces of substrate left. What, Bhikkhus, is Nibbana with residue left? Here, Bhikkhus, a Bhikkhu is an arahant, one whose mental fermentations, Asubha, is silenced, who has fulfilled the noble life, who has done all what needed to be done, who has laid down the burden, attained the gold, who has destroyed the bondages of being, and who is completely released through final knowledge. However, his five sensibilities remain unimpaired. Through these, he still experiences what is agreeable and what is disagreeable, and he feels both pleasure and pain. It is the extinction of greed, hate, and ignorance in this mind that is called the Nibbana element with residue left. So he can still see, hear, taste, touch, and smell. And he still experiences pleasure and pain. With arahat, he pricks himself with a needle in the thigh or in the knee, then he still experiences pain. But he doesn't experience any frustration over this physical pain. So he doesn't experience both physical pain and mental suffering. He doesn't. He experiences only this pain. He says pain, pain. Now what Bhikkhu is a Nibbana element with no residue remaining. Here Bhikkhu is an arahant, one whose mental fermentations is silenced, who has fulfilled the noble life, who has done all what need to be done, who has laid down the burden, attained the goal, who has destroyed the bondages of being, who is fully released through final knowledge. For him there is this very life, all that is experienced, not being delighted in, will grow cold right there and then, and cease. This is the Nibbana element with no residue left. These bhikkhus are the two dimensions of Nibbana. These two Nibbana elements were thus made known by the All-Seeing One, confident and detached. The first is the element with substrates of being remaining, realized here and now, but with rebirth and rebecoming destroyed. So, an arahant from his moment of enlightenment, and then upstream, downstream in time, in the future, then he doesn't have any, there's no rebirth in front of him after death. The other, having no residue left for the future, is that wherein all modes of being utterly cease at the moment of dying on this very same arahant. Having understood this, unconstructed and unconditioned state, released in mind, with the navel string to becoming, eliminated. They attain to the supreme, sublime essence of all states. Delighting in calming and ceasing of all craving, those steady ones have left all being and any becoming irreversibly behind. So again, Nibbana with traces left, Nibbana this very life, still able to sense at the moment of death, Nibbana without any traces of becoming, of re-becoming, of rebirth left. Nibbana an upatisesa. So, this is from the Ittivuttaka, that's what it said, 2.17. About this ultimately released and absolute state that transcends everything, there was a question posed by a monk to Sariputta. A wandering friend once asked the great disciples, Mahasavaka Sariputta, or Sariyut in Sinhala. Friend Sariputta, Nibbana, Nibbana, it is said, what is this Nibbana? Sariputta then answers, the destruction of greed, the destruction of hate, and the destruction of ignorance. This, friend, is called Nibbana. Then the monk asks again, but friend, is there a method, is there a way to reach this Nibbana? Yes, there is indeed a method, friend. There is indeed a way to reach this Nibbana, Sariputta then answers. Then the friend asks, what, friend, is this method? What is then that way to reach Nibbana? Then Sariputta answers, it is, friend, simply the completion of development of this noble eightfold way, namely right view, sammaditti, right motivation, sammasankappa, right speech, sammavaka, right action, sammakamanta, right effort, no, right livelihood, sammajiva, right effort, sammavajama, right awareness, sammasati, and right concentration, sammasamadhi. This undeniably is the very method, friend, the only way to reach Nibbana. Oh, excellent is this unique method, says Sariputta. Exquisite is this way to reach Nibbana. This in itself is enough for me, friend Sariputta, to begin this endeavor. And this is from the Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here, the grouped sayings or connected sayings of the Buddha. Book 4. Sutta number 251. So, if one sums up what is already said now here, it is that Nibbana is the absence of all ignorance, and thereby complete understanding of the Four Noble Truths. That this is suffering, that craving causes this suffering, and that absence of craving therefore is the end of this suffering, and the Noble Eightfold Way is a way to end this suffering. And thereby, in this full understanding, this complete understanding of the Four Noble Truth, because it is suffering, it is seen as suffering, everything is seen as suffering, internally, externally, past, present, future, fair, foul. Then the craving towards it and away from it, the anger, the repulsion, the aversion, it ceases right there. And then there is this qualifying absence of ignorance, absence of greed, and absence of hate. About this immutable, signless sameness, which is real and absolute, yet not to be seen, not to be heard, not to be sensed, the Buddha once said, there is that which is unborn, unborn, uncreated, unformed, unconditioned, and unconstructed. If because there was not this unborn, uncreated, unformed, and unconstructed state, no escape from what is born, created, formed, and constructed could ever be realized. But since there indeed exists that dimension, which is utterly unborn, uncreated, unformed, and unconstructed, the escape from what is born, created, formed, and constructed, can therefore indeed be realized, explained, and made known right here and now. There is an unconditioned, unborn, and ultimate, uncreated absolute. That which is born, that which has come into being, that which is conditioned, that which is dependent, that which is co-arising, that which is created, that which is unstable, unsafe, and thus prone to decay. This seat of disease, this bridge which between birth and death, with nutriment as it calls, will all perish. It is not worth ever clinging to or to rejoice in. The escape from this transience is calm and beyond the sphere of logic. Being that which is safe, stable, that which is unborn, that which is not dependent, independent, and sorrow-free and stainless, this realm is the final ceasing of all states involving any suffering. This stilling of all construction, sabbasankhara, is the absolute bliss and ultimate peace. Udana Inspiration 8.3. So again, one sees that it is not something that can be fantasized to. It's something that can be developed and reached, but it is beyond the sphere of logic. It is beyond the sphere of analytical thinking. The Buddha on this signless sameness of Nibbana. That is the state where there is neither any earth, water, fire, nor any air. Where there is neither trace of solidity, nor fluidity, no heat, no motion. Where there is neither any infinitude of space, nor any infinitude of consciousness, nor any emptiness. Where even no subtle state of neither perception nor non-perception remains. Where there is neither any here, nor any there, nor any in-between. There is neither this or any other world. Where there's neither any sun, nor moon, nor planet, nor universe at all. There, because one cannot designate, point out, or point to, or refer to, any coming, much less any going, nor any remaining, nor any duration, nor any beginning, and thus much less any ending. Neither is there any activity, nor any movement, nor any fixed static stability, nor any ground, basis, cause, or source for any conditioning whatsoever. This unity, singularity, we would say today, this signless sameness only is the end of all suffering. Udana Inspiration 8.1. So here he points to something where I think one can conclude that Nibbana is outside space-time, because it doesn't begin, it doesn't end, it doesn't remain. There's no details, there's no coming and going, no time. There's no sun, no moon, no universe. So it have to be, I think, outside space-time, not included in space-time. So what goes on inside space-time, which is all impermanent, and frustrating because it is always lost, and therefore no self and no substance. This is one thing, and then he points to something else, something beyond that, that is safe and stable. It doesn't contain any spatial, ruminous space characteristics, or any temporal activity, time, change, going characteristics. To we have never really experienced anything beyond space and time. All things that we are placed, now you see this video, you place the monk in front of the tree, so there's a spatial characteristics and there's some evolution in time. What is said is not the same, it's not frozen. So there's development, there's time going. So it is very difficult or impossible to even imagine what it would be to be beyond space and time. One can try, but one usually becomes confused and cannot really grasp the object. So it's a non-spatial, non-temporal, inviable, not varying, non-reactive dimension, this Nibbana, where neither solidity, fluidity, heat or motion find any footing. Nor is there any sun, moon, star shining. There's neither any light, nor is there any darkness. When the noble, through the stilling of all construction, through quieting of all mental formation, directly experiences this, then he is freed both from form and formlessness. Then he is released from both pleasure and pain, and has gone all beyond. Udana 1:10. So again, pointing to something that is beyond fluidity, solidity, heat and motion, the four great elements that forms up all rupa, all things that are formed, all material things, or all materiality, then he points to something that is beyond space-time. Similarly, it is paradoxical in the sense that there's no light, but neither is there any darkness. So these opposites, that these dualisms that we usually form, conceptual dualisms, they are not applicable to this state. You cannot classify it according to these linguistic dualisms of light and dark, pleasure and pain, internal, external, past, present or future. You cannot, because it doesn't apply. Nibbana means gone out. In the same way as a candle, as you see, is gone out because of lack of fuel. And so, an important question, our classical question, is usually if an arahant, worthy, enlightened being, he traverses some limit or some border, that you have Nibbana here and non-Nibbana here. Where has he gone here? Where has he gone, basically? Where do he exist now, if he has gone out? But it is neither applicable. It cannot be applied in this situation. It's like asking if you blow the candle out, where does the flame go? The flame doesn't go anywhere. It doesn't go from here to there. It goes out from here. Like the arahant, he disappears from here when his body is rotten. And then he enters something that is neither here nor there, nor in between. So it cannot be characterized in spatial terms, that is here or over there or somewhere beyond. So it's non-spatial, non-temporal, and there's no pleasure and pain. So of course there's no suffering. In the Dika Nikaya number 16, then the Buddha said to Ananda, the five clusters of clinging, form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness itself has all ceased in Nirvana. If sectarians of other sects now will ask you, Nibbana is the highest bliss, said the Buddha, but how can you experience this bliss without feeling and without perception, without consciousness? If they ask you this question, Ananda, then you should tell them that whatever happiness there is, this the Blessed One calls happiness. So if one should try to understand it a little more, then the commentary says that there's two kinds of consciousness. There's the normal consciousness, which is just a blinking state, which is conscious about something heard, and then the moment after of something seen, and then the moment after of something thought, for example. And if they come very fast, then you have the illusion of being able to perceive both visual stimuli, auditory stimuli, and mental stimuli simultaneously at the same time. But they come really quickly after each other, by the billions per second. So they are discrete events of either auditory consciousness, visual consciousness, and so forth. This kind of consciousness, sense consciousness, always contains an object, a color, a form, a sound, an idea, a touch, or so forth. However, the commentary says, this consciousness of this world, mundane consciousness, is not the only consciousness. There's also a consciousness which is not of this world, which is super mundane. This is transcended, it's above this world. This is not blinking like discrete blinks of consciousness coming very fast. It is continuous. So it is there all the time. And this consciousness can be without an object. Animitta vijnana. Nimitta, sign. Animitta, signless. Signless consciousness. So, the commentary says that this continuous, supramundane, transcendent, signless consciousness, animitta vijnana, is what experiences Nibbana. So Nibbana is still an experience, a perception, but is perceived by a consciousness that is fundamentally different from sense consciousness, which is what disappears. This animitta vijnana, this signless consciousness, has no object apart from this stilled and free peace itself. So where we in this situation with discrete blinks of consciousness have different objects all the time, then this signless consciousness has only the sameness as object. So therefore there's no change in it. This is the highest bliss. The Buddha said, you can by yourself go into various degrees of calm, and then one will see that the fewer the objects during meditation, the fewer the distractions, the less thinking there is, the higher the bliss. So when the number of objects goes down, then the bliss goes up. So one can see some hints about it, even in this very life, that this signlessness, this sameness, this peace is joined with exquisite happiness, exquisite bliss. The Blessed Buddha, he furthermore tried to explain this state in this way. Here, Ananda, the bhikkhu, he considers it all like this. This is a supreme peace. This is a sublime calm. The stilling of all formations. The silencing of all mental construction. The relinquishing of all the substrata fueling existence, the fading away of all craving, a complete detachment, the final mental release, a total cessation, Nirodha. This, only this, is Nibbana. In this way, Ananda, the bhikkhu may enter a mental absorption in which there is no notion of I and mine, no attacks of conceiving any internal consciousness, nor any external objects, and wherein he is both mentally released and fully liberated through understanding of this all. In this silenced and entirely stilled mental state, there's neither any inclination to an I, nor to any mind-making, nor any attacks of conceit by latent tendency to identification, egotism, narcissism, or simple naive realism. This is from the Numerical Discourses, Anguttara Nikaya, 3, Book 3, 32. No I or mind-making is the state. Enraptured and ensnared and obsessed with greed, lust, urgent desire, or enraged with hate, fuming with anger, stirred by ill will and irritation, or blinded by ignorance, agitated by confusion, and fooled by delusion. Thus overwhelmed, with a mind entangled, one aims at own ruin, the ruin of others, or the ruin of both, and one experiences frustration and suffering. But if this lust, hate, and ignorance are eliminated, one aims neither at own ruin, nor at the ruin of others, nor at the ruin of both, and one experiences neither any mental frustration, nor any pain or grief. Thus is Nibbana immediate, visible even in this life, inviting, captivating, fascinating, and comprehensible for any intelligent and wise being. Anguttara Nikaya, the Numerical Discourses of the Buddha, 355. So, again, a standard definition is, it is an elimination of all greed, an elimination, eradication, destruction of all hate, and a evaporation, complete absence of all ignorance. This quenching is Nibbana. So, ignorance is defined in Buddhism as absence of doubt, of confusion about what the Four Noble Truths is. When ignorance of the Four Noble Truths finally fully evaporates, one no longer clings to any sense pleasure, any views, nor any rules or rituals. One no longer clings to any idea of a self, a me, a ego, a soul, or any identity whatsoever. When one does not cling tenaciously, then one is not agitated. One thus remains silent and unperturbed. When mental perturbation is impossible, one attains the state of Nibbana right there. One right then understands rebirth is ended. The noble life has been completed. What had to be done is done. There's no more relapsing into any state of being. So there one sees that is defined as understanding the first fourth noble truth, then mental agitation goes away. There's no craving for anything. Therefore, because craving causes clinging, there's no clinging. No clinging to sense pleasures, no clinging to rules and rituals, and no clinging to an idea that I am, that there is an ego that really am something. A certain not very well-known bhikkhu once asked the Blessed Buddha, "Venerable Sir, the removal of all greed, hate, and ignorance, it is often said. What, Venerable Sir, is the real meaning of that statement?" The removal of greed, hate, and ignorance is a description of the dimension of Nirvana, the Buddha answers. The final elimination of all the mental fermentations is spoken of just like that. So the removal of greed, hate and ignorance equals, by completion of the Noble Eightfold Way, equals, is identical to the state dimension of Nibbana. Then that very same Bhikkhu asks the Blessed One, Venerable Sir, the deathless, it is often said. What, sir, is the deathless? And what is the way leading to the deathless? The destruction of greed, of hate, and the destruction of ignorance. This is called the deathless. The Noble Eightfold Way leading to Nibbana, leading to the deathless, is right view, Samaditti. Right motivation, Sammakamanta. Right speech, Sammavacca. Right action, Sammakamanta. Right livelihood, Sammajiva. Right effort, Sammavajjhama. Right awareness, Sammasati. And right concentration, Sammasamadhi. So, while it looks so difficult to express, the definition of it, absence of greed, hate and ignorance, and the way leading thereto, the Noble Eightfold Way, is simple. And there, I think, one, it points to the way that stop babbling, stop intellectualizing, focus on developing the Noble Eightfold Way by understanding the Four Noble Truths to a complete degree. This is the way. Then Nibbana will emerge by itself. One cannot babble or fantasize or intellectualize or use hammer it out with logic, as the Buddha say, analytical thinking. It doesn't work like that, because all these intellectual exercises, jumping from one part of the tree to another part of the tree, also called views, do not lead to the end of ignorance. It leads to more confusion and what has recently been coined as papancha, conceptual proliferation, where one gets more and more ideas, more and more discriminations, until the mind is full of them and one can write thick books about them. But this is not the way to Nibbana. It's not a simplification. It's not a unification. It is not a singularity. It is a proliferation into an endless diversity of views, many of which is wrong. As Savati, the Blessed Buddha, once said to his monks, I will teach you the uncorrupted state and the way to this uncorrupted state, because I will teach you the truth and the way leading to this absolute truth. I will teach you the far shore, the subtle, the sublime, the difficult to see, the unaging, the stable, the safe, the undisintegrating and the undecaying state, the unmanifested, the unproliferated, the unclinging, the untroubled. I'll teach you the way to the silence, the peaceful, the supreme bliss, the fortunate, the wonderful, the amazing cooling of all craving. The dissolution, the purity, the freedom, the island shelter, the assured asylum, the final refuge. I'll teach you the way to the deathless destination, Nibbana. Listen and pay alert attention to that, which will lead you to lasting happiness. And what, Bhikkhus, is this Nibbana? Again, the absence of all greed, the absence of all hate, and the absence of all ignorance. This is called the uncorrupted state of Nibbana. And what, Bhikkhus, is this very good way leading to this undying state of Nibbana? And then follows what is later called the 37 requisites to Nibbana, or to awakening, the 37 Bodhipakkhiya Dhamma, the 37 states that produce enlightenment and thereby make Nibbana emerge, which is awareness of the body just as organs is a way to this uncorrupted state. The four foundations of awareness, sati satipatthana, are a way to this absolute truth. Calm and profound insight is a way to the far shore. Absorption into directed thought and sustained examination is a way. Absorption into emptiness, signlessness, and the uninclined is a way. The four right efforts are a way. This is a very difficult to see state. The four roads to force is a way to this supreme bliss. The five abilities are a way to this freedom. The five pure powers are a way to this freedom. The seven links to enlightenment, Satta Sambhayanka, are a way to this peace. The Noble Eightfold Way is a way to this deathless destination. These are the ways leading to Nibbana. I have now taught you Nibbana and the way leading to this Nibbana. Whatever should be done, because by a considerate teacher, out of sympathy for his disciples, wishing only their welfare, that I have now done for you. There are roots of trees, because there are empty huts. Meditate, do not neglect your meditation, because otherwise you may come to regret it later. This is our instruction to you. There are roots of trees, there are empty huts. Meditate, meditate, meditate. This is the way. Then one will not regret it later. It's also from Samyutta Nikaya, which you see here, the group sayings of the Buddha. So it doesn't come without effort. The sublime is only won by sublime or supreme training. This one should think, there's no free lunch here either. This gone out state, how can it be characterized? If we should try to characterize it, then it is peaceful, it is tamed, it is smokeless, it is wishless, it is harmless, it is unobstructed, both in front and behind. It is untroubled, unconcerned with both past and future. It is pure, it is aloof, imperturbable, beyond wavering and doubt. It is confident, directly knowing. It is calmed and free. The Arahant, the worthy one, the enlightened one, enters this final state, the cooling of all craving, the stilling of all mental construction, the releasing of all clinging, the relinquishing, letting go of all acquisition, detachment, disillusion, ceasing, formless, senseless, and deathless. This absolute peace, blissfully pure, silent, and free. Such is Nibbana. Ta-ta-ta. For him who has completed this journey, for him who is untouched by any pain or sorrow, for him who is in every way wholly freed, for him who has broken all chains, for such one, how can any suffering ever be possible? Dhammapada 91. So, Nibbana is the purpose of the noble life. And once explained this like this, when asked about the purpose of morality, sila, is control of behavior and thereby karma. The purpose of this controlled behavior is absence of regrets and remorse. The purpose of absence of regrets is joy. The purpose of joy and gladness is satisfaction. The purpose of satisfaction is calm, not looking for anything, already satisfied. The purpose of calm is happiness. The purpose of happiness is concentration, samadhi. The purpose of concentration is understanding it just as it really is. Yada Buddha, jnana. The purpose of understanding is disillusion, viraga. The purpose of disillusion is detachment. The purpose of detaching is mental release. The purpose of mental release is Nibbana. Final freedom without any remnants of any clinging left. Final freedom. So the sequence actually goes, it starts with sila, then it comes over samadhi, concentration, which then calms the mind down to see things as they really are. And this then becoming disillusioned with it, having no illusions about that they are happiness, and they are lasting, and they are self, or me, or mine, or can be kept, or owned. It doesn't have any illusions about that. And therefore it detaches. What are the subtle qualities or properties of Nibbana? Nibbana is total ease, complete calm, absolute freedom, supreme happiness, and pure peace. It is absence of any uncertainty, any doubt, any confusion, any delusion, and is absence of all ignorance. It is presence of confidence, certainty, understanding, and complete direct experience. It is absence of any greed, lust, desire, any urge, attraction, hunger, and any temptation. It is presence of an imperturbable and serene composure inside an all-stilled, silenced equanimity. It is absence of all hate, anger, aversion, irritation, opposition, and stubborn rigidity. It is presence of universal goodwill, infinite and all-embracing, gentle and friendly kindness. Nibbana is not a place. It is not a location, not an idea, not a fantasy, not a deception, not a conceit. It is not finite, not definable, not conceptual. It is neither a cause nor an effect. It is not formed, not begun, not beginning, not ending, not changing, not temporal. It is timeless and thus everlasting. Nibbana is unborn, unbecome, unmade, uncreated, uncaused, unconditioned, unconditional, and all unconstructed. It is not influenced. It's not a reflection. It is unimagined and unimaginable and is therefore ultimately real. Nibbana is void of seeing, void of visible objects and visible consciousness or visual consciousness. It is void of hearing, sounds and auditory consciousness. It is void of smelling, smells and olfactory consciousness. It is void of tasting, tastes and gustatory consciousness. It is void of body, touch, and tactile consciousness. It is void of mind, ideas, thoughts, thinking, and all mental consciousness. Thus it is pure peace at rest. The Blessed Buddha, he said, hard it is to see the unconstructed, the undistorted. This independent state is not easily realized. Craving is all cut for the one who so knows. Since he sees, there's nothing to cling to. There's not. Nothing is worth clinging to. Udana Inspiration 8.2. The Udana and the Ittivuttaka, two small works of the Tipitaka, contains these short sentences that I think make good sense. I'll give them a link to them below. They are both in book form and freely published. It's very good translation by John D. Ireland. In any dependence, there's bound to be instability. If you depend upon something and then you remove whatever something is dependent upon, then it disappears. So there's instability. In free independence, there cannot be any instability. When there's no liable instability, no feeble wavering, there's a quiet calm, a stillness, a serenity, a peace, not of this world. When there is such solid tranquility, then there's no drive to drift along or skate away. Neither is there any mental push nor any pull in the mind. There's no attraction, nor any strain of appeal, nor is there any repulsion of the mind. When there's no attraction, no drift, no bending, then neither is there any movement, chain, or transience, nor any coming, and thus much less any going away. Neither is there any starting, nor any ending occurring. When there's neither any coming, nor any going, then there's neither any ceasing, nor any reappearance or rebirth. When there's neither any ceasing nor any reappearing, then there's neither any here nor there, nor beyond, nor even in between. This, just this, is the end of suffering. Udana Inspiration 8.4. So it is, once he said there's no time, so you cannot talk about beginning and end. And you cannot talk about any development, any activity, any construction. So it is not temporal, it is timeless, akaliko. It is outside any space-time. It is not included in samsara. It is something else. Something else. Something beyond. Something truly transcendent. Having understood this unconstructed state, released in mind, when the chain of becoming is eliminated, they attain to this supreme and sublime essence of all states. Delighting in the calm end of all craving, those steady noble ones have left all being and any repeated becoming irreversibly all behind. Ittivuttaka, thus spoken, 38. All behind, they have left it all behind. One who so knows sees that there's nothing to cling to. Nibbana is, therefore, the highest bliss. When one has given up all clinging, then one experiences his bliss. There's two essays, the Doctrine of Nibbana. I'll give the link to this essay. And then there's a fairly large book, both in book form, and this is also on YouTube, read out and translate it. And it is also as a free PDF file, and it's 33 speeches, sermons from the 2003 to 2008 by Bhikkhu Nanananda, Katukurunde Nanananda Thera, which you see here. It's very famous. It's fairly large work, around 800 pages, which is a transcription of this 33 Dhamma speeches about Nibbana. Nibbana, the mind stilled. I gave the PDF file yesterday. But it's basically 8 years' work from a monk late in his life. They are freely available, several places. On seeingthroughthenet.net and on whatbuddhasaid.net, this PDF file is freely available. Question, I give the link below. Question 334. What is the minimum type and time one should practice daily meditation? 1 hour, 15 minutes, walking, sitting, metta, and so on. Asubha, vipassana, which method? Yeah, if one starts from full start, then I would say 15 minutes is suitable. And then jack it up to 45 minutes, at least minimum once daily. What type? Anapanasati breathing meditation, which is calming of all conceptual thinking, and at the same time it induces, it trains all the four satipatthanas, and it develops the seven links to awakening. this I can recommend for all, and then there's no side effects. So it establishes mindfulness on the breath and the nostrils. This can be used by all, and I think should be used by all. Then one second meditation object should be tailored. Basically, the greedy ones who eat slowly, taste a lot, walk slowly, and has a tendency to overweight, they should use Asubha skeleton meditation, or corpse meditation, or body scanning, organ scanning. And they should establish a sign of disgust, an Asubha nimitta in their mind, which they can redirect mind to whenever they're overcome by lust and greed. The opposite one, those who eat fast and walk fast and has a tendency to irritation and opposition, who are the angry ones, they should use metta, universal friendliness, or the four Brahma Viharas as meditation object. Karuna, compassion, infinite compassion, mutual joy, mudita, infinite mutual joy, rejoicing in other beings' success, and upekkha. So these four Brahma Viharas will make the angry ones fizzle away. Those who are dominated by doubt, uncertainty, confusion, hesitation, intellectualization, they should use insight meditation, vipassana. Primarily one should use sitting meditation in a comfortable position, cross-legged but not necessarily in lotus position. One can also sit on a chair. A sofa is not usually not very suitable because one falls asleep and is unstable position. So cross-legged with a straight back, which comes naturally when you lift up the head like this, not up the chin up, nor the chin low, it starts to fall low naturally. Just lift up like this, with the thumbs here in the lower jaw, then one sits right, then sits comfortable, because otherwise if you sit in pain, you give up the meditation, because it's too frustrating. If one do more than one sitting daily, more than one 45 minutes sitting daily, then it can be interspersed by 45 minutes sitting, then half an hour or 45 minutes walking meditation, walking back and forth or in a circle, usually alone. Good to establish mindfulness, seeing the foot lifting, the foot pushing, the foot sitting down, can be followed up by various other stages, and then it refreshes the body to do another 45 minutes sitting. The important thing is not so much how long it is, but just that it's done every day. So it's an everyday practice. If not done in the morning, ideal case 5 in the morning or maybe 4. Some in the afternoon, then in the evening. But the later you come in the day, the more you eat and the more you work, the more difficult it becomes to do. This mental training is essential to any approach on the Noble Eightfold Way and also to any, I would say, deeper well-being in samsara, because otherwise one is kicked about by these ever-changing circumstances, especially health-wise, economically, socially, and so forth. Even the weather will affect one's mind more than necessary. Question 335. What did the Buddha say about Deva's ability to see and interact with human beings? A cut short, they can see us, but we cannot see them, especially with the exception of special circumstances. It is told that Sariputta and also the Buddha and Mahamogyana three times while they were there made a wonder that made the humans see both the hills and the hungry ghost and the devas at the same time. So it became more or less transparent. I think it is like this, that that there's our time frames, that we are existing discreetly here and there, and then the devas time frame of existence is in between. This means that if you start to sample a larger portion of time in one state, then you will see both worlds. Actually, so you could say, if you on a film had one picture from this, the human dimension, and then one picture from the devas dimension, and then one picture from the ghost dimension, and one picture from the hell dimension, and then you roll it up like a film frame, 30 frames per second, then you would see on the screen of consciousness, you would see all four worlds. But this is not normally the case. But there's this asymmetry. They can see us, but we cannot see them. The lower devas from the Kama Loka up to level 11, they can talk with us through a normal voice. If the Brahma devas that usually communicate with telepathically, they should talk to us, then they have to make up a gross form. And there once came a Brahma deva to the Buddha, and then he tried to stand on the word, on the earth inside the Buddha's kuti, then he was sinking, so to speak. And then he said, "I'm sinking, I'm sinking." Then the Buddha said to him, "Ah, you have to make a gross form, a gross material form like we have." Then he would stand on the earth and be able to speak with sound. Otherwise, it will go through telepathy. It's still verbal activity. It's like when you speak to yourself, you can say inside yourself without sound. Then you use the words 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So it is conceptual thinking, it is verbal activity. This verbal activity, when telepathy communication is going on, appears without sound, but it's still words, it is still concepts, it's still ideas. I hope this answers the questions and was a fitting exposition of some, at least, aspects of Nibbana, those who can be expressed in words, at least. Thank you for your attention, your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was this blessed Buddha indeed. Thank you also to all the Dayakas, supporters, and donors. Thank you for your attention, and may you have a nice and noble day.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.